Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to get started here because I like to be prompt. I'd like to welcome everybody to the annual Economic and Revenue Consensus Forecasting Conference. I am Sandra Beatty from the New York State Division of Budget. Joining me today on the Joint Economic and Revenue panel is Senator Gennardis, Chair of the Senate Committee on Budget and Revenue, Assemblymember Weinstein, Chair of the Assembly Ways and Means Committee, Senator Griffo, Assistant Minority Leader, Assemblymember Ra, Ranking Member of the Assembly Ways and Means Committee, and Maria Dulles, Deputy State Comptroller. I'd also like to thank today's presenters, Chris Vivares, Hugh Johnson, Jason Brehm, and Karan Bashin. Thank you all for coming to be with us again this year. And we brought the weather for you who could not join. Today's conference represents the latest step as we work towards a balanced and on-time budget, following years of unprecedented challenges for the state, the nation, and the world. Each member of the panel will have an opportunity to provide brief opening remarks. Then we will hear testimony from a cross-section of our experts who will offer their perspectives on our current economic and revenue status. Since the initial and dramatic job losses at the onset of the pandemic in April and March 2020, New York has made significant steps towards recovery. As of December 2022, the state had recovered 86.5% of its 2 million pandemic-related job losses. However, despite these significant gains, the state continues to trail the nation, which recovered its pandemic-related job losses by June of 2022. Since we met last February, the national economy experienced two consecutive overall growth declines in the first two quarters of 2022. However, despite a strong rebound in the second half of the year, growth to date appears to have slowed, with more than half of economists predicting a mild or even deeper recession in 2023. As we highlighted last year, the state economy continues to be affected by the COVID-19 pandemic, with an uneven employment recovery across industries and the ever-present threat of out-migration. While real GDP surpassed its pre-COVID level in the second quarter of 2021, employment for the state is not expected to return to pre-pandemic levels until 2027. Consistent with the Congressional Budget Office's economic outlook from earlier this February, DOB's economic and, importantly, revenue and overall fiscal outlook are premised on the economy only experiencing a mild slowdown with a quick recovery. But we are cognizant and alert to the many risks that could derail us. Accordingly, the strong receipts, growth, and resultant surpluses the state has enjoyed over the past few quarters should be carefully managed to avoid what history has so often taught us. Economies are inherently vulnerable to a variety of known and unknown risks that can quickly eliminate projected gains and surpluses, including the recent out-migration of high-income taxpayers. Therefore, I am interested in hearing the assessment of our expert panel, particularly, do you share the division's forecast for a mild recession in 2023? And if so, how deeply do you anticipate the economic slowdown to be? And what are the key risks to your forecast? And what, in your estimation, should New York do to maintain its competitive economic advantages and speedily return to sustainable growth across all industries? My hope is that our panel of experts will be able to comment on these risks and contribute others we haven't heard yet thought of. Once again, we embark upon the revenue consensus process as the state and the nation appear to be heading towards hopefully only a mild recession. The types of actions proposed in the executive budget on both the revenue and spending sides are responsible and necessary to strengthen New York's fiscal position and to guard against unexpected economic or other shocks. We need to be continually mindful of national budgetary trends, such as CBO's projected larger federal deficits and increasing federal debt, as they may inhibit the ability of the federal government to support states in future crises. Over the last several years, we have worked to enact timely, fiscally responsible budgets that embrace the principles that state spending, absent extreme emergencies, must grow more slowly than the economy, all the while carefully managing state tax policy to ensure our state's competitive position. All parties deserve credit for responsible budget making. Each of the forecasts before us today represents a good faith contribution to the consensus process. I know that we are all committed to meeting the statutory March 1 deadline for a consensus revenue agreement. Revenue consensus is an important component of achieving our shared goal of a timely and responsible enacted budget. At this point, I would like to offer other members of the panel an opportunity to make their opening remarks. And before that, I just would like to thank the staffs that support all of us up here, because if it was not for you all, we would not be sitting here able to do our jobs. So thank you. Now I'd like to turn it over to Senator Gennardis.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Last year, we were facing a multi-year financial plan with historic surpluses driven by federal aid funds and increasing taxes on the wealthy. Now the executive is projecting out-year budget deficits. However, the state has made significant progress in growing our rainy day funds, and we are looking to continue to make investments in both our fiscal stability and critical services and infrastructure. With COVID-19 restrictions in the rearview mirror, the U.S. and New York State economies are poised to maintain favorable economic conditions. Inflation, one of the factors that can impact our economic growth, remains a concern despite moving lower from its historic highs from last year. Largely in response to heightened international tensions, internationally traded commodities such as oil, metals, wheat, and others have been volatile over the past year with measurable effects on input costs and cost of living. We must be prepared for additional economic impacts that may arise, as well as for the opportunities the current economic situation may present. Our state budget is due by April 1st, and our revenue consensus is due tomorrow. With that in mind, I look forward to hearing the testimony of our experts here today, which will help inform the receipts forecast that serve as the basis for this year's coming budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Weinstein?
Thank you very much. I'm pleased to be here today, and as others have said, I look forward to hearing the panelists' thoughts on the economic outlook for both the state and the nation, with a particular focus on your views about the outlook for New York State economy and the risks and uncertainties we face going forward. The state's economy has rebounded strongly from the depths of the recession brought on by the pandemic, but the state continues to lag, as was said, the nation in several key indicators and faces slowing growth of employment and income this year. Although the coming down from the four decade highs, inflation remains elevated, and we are acutely aware of the impacts that inflation has on many households in the state. Particularly interested in hearing your outlook for the national and state economies, both in the short term and in the longer term as the economic recovery continues. This analysis is important to us each year as we look to evaluate the current economic conditions and to respond as effectively as possible. Your independent viewpoints, along with today's discussion, will help to provide a solid foundation as we debate various aspects of the budget. I thank the advisors for being here today, and I want to join in thanking all of our staffs for their hard work in going forward with the budget.
Thank you, Assemblywoman. Senator Griffall.
Thank you. Appreciate the opportunity to be here today. As we all know, the COVID-19 pandemic has created much upheaval and upended so many aspects of our lives. And while we continue to recover and work our way through a post-pandemic world, we continue to face an uncertain economy, one that includes high inflation, slumping consumer confidence, and other economic pressures that continue to cause significant economic challenges, such as escalating energy costs, significant job shortages, and the remote work approach that now faces many employers. The ending of substantial federal funding, which has been allocated to the state during the pandemic. High unemployment insurance rates that are burdening businesses. And we see New Yorkers continually leaving the state in exodus as at an alarming rate evidenced by statistics from the U.S. Department of Census. The limited amount of opportunities concerns many of us right now. So what we need to do is take a look at what is happening and to provide for real and significant relief for New Yorkers. New York has been on a spending spree, an alarming and unsustainable rate over the last 4 years. The budgets have increased 33% over that time, and debt has increased over 21.3% during that time period. We have had, it should be noted, and it's been documented, that New York has had the slowest recovery in the nation from the recession, and we are showing equally an equally slow recovery from the pandemic across this nation. So that is something that we need to keep in mind. We continue to see our state lag behind other states. Our conference has projected that 23 revenue and 24 revenue could be almost $1.86 billion above the executive. And I do believe that the legislative conferences are projecting similar revenues over $1.7 billion higher than the executive. And I think it is important that we resist, in all cases, any additional tax increases in the enacted budget, and strongly recommend that any additional revenue that we could potentially see above the executive projection be used to pay down over the $9 billion that New York has borrowed from the federal government for unemployment insurance that continues to burden our businesses. So the volatility exists. We need to be aware of that, and we have to be willing to confront that accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Assemblyman Raw, please.
Thank you. Thank you to colleagues in the legislature and the executive for being here, as well as our presenters today. I'm generally supportive of some of the initiatives in this budget for deposits into reserve funds and the commitment to fully funding foundation aid. However, the executive cuts to libraries, special education, schools, and veterans programs in a budget of $227 billion seem misguided. I continue, like in years past, to be concerned about out-migration, and as you all know, report after report has shown New York's population decline as residents flee just 180,000, over 180,000 within the last year. And our tax climate is consistently ranked one of the worst in the nation, another factor that greatly contributes to out-migration. And once again, we are seeing a temporary tax increase that looks like it's going to continue to be extended in perpetuity. I'm increasingly concerned about the impact of state fiscal policies have on everyday New Yorkers, our small businesses, and our local governments, which will only lead to an increased out-migration and further over-taxation. And I think some of the proposals in this budget will only perpetuate that unfriendly environment and further drive people away, including the continuation of the temporary business tax, potential minimum wage increase, increasing MTA payroll taxes, and diverting casino money from education, Medicaid money from our counties, flat AIM funding, and the lack of further inflation relief, coupled with unfunded mandates being placed on residents, businesses, and local governments. I'm interested in our panelists' analysis on the state economy concerning these topics and your analysis on the federal economy from inflationary pressures, energy initiatives, increased crime, workforce shortages, unemployment levels, and the impact of international affairs. I thank you very much again for being here and look forward to working with the executive and the other legislative conferences in an open and transparent budget process that provides New Yorkers with an on-time and responsible state budget. Thank you.
Thank you. Maria Dulles, please.
Thank you, and thank you to the panelists who are taking the time today to join us and share their insights and perspectives. As Comptroller DiNapoli has noted, revenues in the current year remain strong, with collections greater than initially anticipated. Year-to-date tax receipts are $12.6 billion higher than enacted budget forecasts. However, the state faces growing budget gaps, and there are significant headwinds that will present challenges to continued economic growth and the state's finances. While forecasting the state's tax revenues is inherently challenging in any year, the current economic environment has made it more so and requires careful consideration of the latest economic data. The PTET has also added a new layer of complexity to forecasting. With personal income taxes representing a substantial portion of state tax receipts, particular focus should be paid to assessing the components of personal income growth and taxpayer behavior. the state must prepare for rainy days ahead. The Comptroller supports the executive's plan to accelerate deposits to the state's reserves and supports increasing maximum allowable deposits and balances of the state's statutory rainy day reserves. He urges your continued commitment to building these statutory reserves. Thank you, and I look forward to the presentations.
Thank you, everyone. We'll now go to Chris Vavaris, who will be on the web.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hopefully you can hear me. It's nod of head or yes?
Yes, we can hear you. Thank you.
Fantastic. Okay, so you have my, first of all, thank you again for inviting me to participate in this really important process. I think it's a great model for states around the country, and it obviously seems to work. So I'm going to focus my remarks today on our view of the U.S. economy and the prospects or not for a mild recession. So let's go to page three. I've got some of the main bullet points there. Clearly for us, the key determinant is the stickiness of inflation. So the U.S. economy finds itself today with inflation unacceptably high. This has elicited an aggressive response from the Federal Reserve. We do anticipate that inflation will fall as some of the idiosyncratic overshoot, in particular prices related to the post-pandemic environment, reverse, as well as when slack in the economy begins to develop as a result of a period of slow growth or mildly contracting economy. Commodity prices, as we know, have already come down, and that's exerting some downward pressure on commodity prices, on goods prices. And we still have a way to go to fully resolve all of the supply issues, which should also help to reduce some goods prices. However, labor markets remain very tight, and this means that wage growth is quite firm. This does support higher inflation for longer, and it does also contribute to high service price inflation, where there's a higher labor component in services than there is in goods. We do expect a rise in the unemployment rate, which will lead to a decline in wage inflation over time, and this will contribute to the disinflation that we expect. However, the disinflation that is getting inflation from 4.5-5% range down to 2%, which is the Fed's target, is going to be a multi-year process. And as a result, the Fed is going to have its foot on the brakes for some time. So the Fed has raised the federal funds policy rate 4.5 percentage points since early last year. We anticipate a peak in the target range at 5 to 5.25 in the forecast I'm discussing today, but we're in the middle of revising that forecast, and we've already decided that we will see 3 more quarter point moves. So the top of the federal funds rate will go to 5.5%, with a possibility that it could go still higher if inflation proves more intransigent. So you're probably aware that as of last October, financial conditions were quite tight. However, from mid-October to late October, all the way through early February, financial conditions in the economy, which would include the level of interest rates, spreads to private bond yields and mortgages, the value of the dollar, and the level of the stock market, all improved dramatically from mid-October to early February. And that improvement in financial conditions basically undermined a good part of the effort that the Fed had made over the past year or more to slow the economy, to bring demand in better balance with supply. Since that time, financial conditions, aided by Federal Reserve officials' tough talk that they still have more work to do, that inflation's not coming down as fast as they had hoped, have led to a worsening of financial conditions that we believe will still keep the economy growing slowly or slip into a mild recession at some point this year. So the key reasons for that recession are that fiscal support continues to wane. For example, the last piece going out now is the child tax credit. So that looks like a big reduction in transfer support for low-income folks. Pent-up demand, which has been gradually released for the goods part, that's been going sort of sideways for services. Most of that pent-up demand has been released. So there's not a lot of impulse from that part of the economy. the worsening financial conditions that I already alluded to, surging prices also erode real income and wealth, and that is a restraint on consumer spending. And finally, foreign growth has been sagging, especially in Europe, where the impact of the invasion of Ukraine by Russia has spiked energy prices. And despite the decline in energy prices, there's a lasting effect on economic growth in Europe, and that has spilled beyond that. So that's the sort of big picture. What are some of the risks? The risks include what I call policy imperfection. This includes the fact that the Fed may not get the soft landing perfectly right. It could be a bumpy landing, sort of like this mild recession scenario that we're thinking about, or it could be a lot worse. So financial conditions could tighten very dramatically over the next several months, in which case we could have a much harder landing. And a big part of the what will determine that is, again, the stickiness of inflation. How hard does the Fed have to stomp on the brakes? And then what spillovers will that have to the real side of the economy, to employment, and to income? And of course, still in the background are the possible intensification of the war in Ukraine and new COVID variants. We'll go on to the next page. This just quickly illustrates a couple of the key features that I was mentioning. First is the unacceptably high inflation. So this is the core personal consumption expenditure price increase in the left-hand chart. Annualized rates of change over 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, just so you can see whether there is momentum. And there has been a peak. Rates have begun to come down. Rates of inflation have begun to come down, but it's still unacceptably high. And January's figure was a whopper, 7% plus at an annual rate. So you can see the 3 month change there turning up, the 6 month change, you know, turning up again. So this, I think, has really, financial markets have sort of taken this as a sign that the Fed needs to do more. The Fed speakers have said they need to do more. I think we need to take them at their word, and hence why in our new forecast that we're working on, we see the Fed funds rate going to 5.5 or higher. On the right-hand side illustrates the tightness in the labor market. The blue line is the traditional unemployment rate. The gold line shows the unemployment rate if you also subtract from it the number of open jobs. So this just tells you just how tight the labor market is. There's just way more open positions than there are people and willing to take those jobs. This is sometimes expressed as the ratio of openings to unemployed, which has been a number around 2 jobs for every unemployed person. But you can see this is the tightest really the labor market has ever been. And that's one of the reasons we're seeing wage growth as high as it's been. Going to the next chart, next page on slide 5, you can see the increase in the federal funds rate path that we implemented in our February forecast. As inflation has proved more intransigent, we've been pushing the peak in the funds rate a bit higher, recognizing that the Fed is going to just have to do more. But this has already translated into a fairly significant tightening in financial conditions, as you can see in the right-hand chart. Just focus on the mortgage rate for a minute. The conventional mortgage rate has jumped 300 plus percentage points. It has led to a very significant slowing in housing demand and housing construction. And we expect that to be a continued weight on residential construction going forward. And for example, in the second half of last year, the decline in housing subtracted something roughly 1.5 percentage points from GDP growth. And we're going to see continued drag on GDP in the first half of 2023. Other rates have also risen fairly sharply. We think that Treasury yields are near their peak. We do see the 10-year Treasury yield going up to about 4%. Average in the second quarter, but coming down very slowly from there. And so that will, of course, influence all term yields in the financial markets. Going to the next slide. This chart is to make the point that when financial conditions ease broadly in the economy, as happens from October to February, it tends to raise economic growth. It reduces borrowing costs, the dollar comes down, it makes our exports more competitive. So that easing in the and financial conditions boost growth, and that boost to growth then, because we're talking about growth and demand, it is undoing what the Fed is attempting to get demand to slow to become in better alignment with supply. And as a result, then the Fed has to raise interest rates even more to achieve its goals. So this easing of financial conditions, which ran contrary to the Fed's goals, now has to be undone. And that means the Fed has to work harder to do it. So expect higher interest rates. So an important alternative scenario is that inflation does not come down as quickly as we expect or as the Fed hopes. And as a result, the Fed has to push rates even higher, which will slow the economy to achieve the disinflation that they seek, but it could also result in a harder landing than we might otherwise have seen. We'll go on to the next page. The left-hand chart shows the S&P 500 stock index. You can see the very sharp decline there from middle of last year towards the end of last year, which represented that tightening in financial conditions. It weakens personal consumption expenditures through the so-called wealth effect. It can raise the equity cost of capital to firms, and so it has a negative impact on growth. There has been that recovery that I mentioned since October through early February, and we now see, as a result of the higher inflation and the Fed raising rates more than previously expected, that recovery is going to be aborted for most of this coming year. When you look at the right-hand chart, this shows the profile and the major contributors to the recession. So Q4, we had growth over 2%. In Q1, in this forecast, we had growth slightly less than 1%, with a big contributor being a decline in the pace of inventory investment. So it does take production to make goods that pile up in inventory. If firms no longer want to raise levels of inventories, they cut orders, they cut production. And so that's a contributor to slower growth in GDP. But also a key measure of the health of the domestic economy is what we call domestic final sales. So we take out inventory building, we take out net exports, and we're simply asking domestic residents, purchasers, we call them, what are they buying? And is there growth there? And we do expect sort of a flat profile there for the next couple of quarters, down slightly in this forecast. Remains to be seen. Personal consumption expenditures proved to be fairly strong in January. Weather was unusually warm. There's difficulty with seasonal adjustment in January. So we don't know whether that was a significant head fake or whether that will prove to be something that's more sustained. And if it is more sustained, then we will be revising the forecast up to show less of a recession, maybe a negative number for GDP won't come in until the second quarter. But at this point, as we're putting the forecast to bed, it looks like both Q1 and Q2 will see negative growth in GDP. But again, there are risks both to the upside and to the downside. I'm going to skip ahead to slide 9. I alluded to one of the sources of softness in the economy to being the fact that pent-up demand may be largely exhausted. So we've taken consumer expenditures here and split it into two of its major components. On the bottom part is expenditure on durable goods, which we know jumped in the pandemic period and immediate aftermath, as folks were sitting at home noticing that they needed to replace the couch and the chair and all those things. And so there was a big burst of spending on durable goods, and that has sort of gone sideways. It's converging back to its pre-pandemic trend. Services, on the other hand, took a much bigger hit in the downward direction. There was an early quick recovery, but in the last several quarters, that has really slowed. So while its services consumption is still rising faster than overall consumption, if the economy slips into recession as we expect, we get kind of a sideways waffle there in services spending. So, and again, it's largely because there's just not that much more pent-up demand to be released in this part of consumer spending. Going on to the next slide. This shows the mild profile of the recession. In the forecast we have in front of us today, the bars are annualized rates of change in GDP. You can see that in the first couple of quarters of the year, there's not much negative there, But the recovery starts in the third quarter, but it's kind of lackluster. And as a result of that, we do see the unemployment rate edging up to from 3.5 to 4.5 is, I think, a rough way of putting it, sufficiently that it would help to slow the rate of wage growth. But it would rank among the milder recessions in the U.S. post-World War II economic history. So that kind of puts the degree of the recession in perspective. There's not much there, but it hopefully is enough to get inflation to slow. Let's jump ahead to slide 12. Just to cover a few points about wages and some other important tax considerations. So on the left-hand chart, it shows productivity. This is output. Measured output per hour in the non-farm business sector. It has followed a trend since 2017 of growing at about 1.5% per year. It surged during the pandemic as a lot of low productivity workers were let go and people left the labor force. Firms had to figure out how to deal with fewer workers to produce output. So productivity surged. And it's been coming down unevenly. We now see it having approached the pre-pandemic trend, and we expect that it will then rise accordingly. So 1.5% growth of productivity is fairly good. I mean, we went from 2008, 2009 through about 2015, where productivity growth was quite a bit weaker. Then when we look at compensation per hour in the private non-farm sector, of course, it surged for the same reason. Dropping off low wage workers causes the average level of compensation per hour to rise. It fell back down when we brought many of those workers back. And now we're bouncing around 4%. Well, 4% growth of hourly compensation, if productivity is 1.5%, gets you to growth of unit labor costs, which is closer to 2.5%. It's much higher than would be consistent with 2% inflation. So what has to happen is compensation growth needs to slow back, because we can't wave a magic wand and make productivity go to 2%. So we need compensation growth to slow back closer to 3.5%. That would be consistent with 2% inflation given constant profit margins. And that's part of what the Fed is trying to accomplish through its continuation of its tightening. I would point out with respect to some of the income measures. So when we talk about non-wage income, we know about capital gains income and our conversations with the Bureau of Economic Analysis and the kinds of assumptions they're making for declarations and settlements this year is that they will be considerably below what they were last year, because there'll be many fewer realized capital gains upon which taxes will be paid. So a fairly significant decline in taxes on capital on capital gains is in the offing. The other thing is we know the difficulties that the financial industry has been facing. I know you guys are close to this and on top of it, but we can expect that bonus payments will be reduced relative to what they had been in years past. And so for that component of source of tax revenue, that will also be depressed relative to past years. And finally, the last chart, we go on to just talk about where inflation ends up. So you can see this is the core PC inflation rate. You can see it peaking there just under 6% earlier last year. We have it, as I said, it's a multi-year process to get core PC inflation back down to 2%. I have to say, you know, we're putting some judgmental liens here, raising the risk that inflation may not come down as fast as we are forecasting. And if that is the case, then it's likely, as I've noted a couple of times already, that the Fed will be stepping on the brakes harder. And so, you know, as you're thinking about managing the risks, yes, things in the near term might be a little better than represented in this forecast. But if they are, it raises the risk that they're going to be materially worse later, because the Fed is going to have to deal with the intransigent inflation. And I will leave it there.
Thank you, Chris. Hugh?
Yeah, thank you very much. You can't ask for a more comprehensive and really more precise forecast than what I hear every year when I come here from Chris. He's really, really very good at it. And you almost don't need the rest of us to speak, quite frankly. At any rate, I will. There's one expression, which it's sort of a warning, which I'll give you, and that's one of my favorite expressions about economists, is often wrong, never in doubt. And you'll hear that from myself and every other economist. And I think it's worth keeping in mind, I've tracked forecasts, economic forecasts, back to 1987, month by month. And there's a two-year forecast period, and to see how they do. And it's worth just keeping in the back of your head. And I'm more than happy to share the data with you. I don't think you need to, but just simply stated, is you'll see that the forecasts are, especially at the beginning of the two-year forecast period, wrong. Secondly, is that they tend to pull in the direction of the outcome, and they get it right, of course, at the end of the forecast period. Of course, then you have all the numbers. But nevertheless, you have they either start too high and they pull in the direction of the outcome, or they start too low and they pull in the direction of the outcome. And that tends to be, very consistent over time. I think the good news, or somewhat good news, I don't know if this is good news, is that the number for 2023 right now is very low. And that gives me the suggestion, I would say guess, hunch, hope, that maybe that forecast will pull in the right direction or pull higher during the two-year forecast period. I wouldn't bank on it, but nevertheless, it's worth mentioning. What I do, and I'm going to try to be somewhat brief and certainly clear, is what I tend to try to do is to match up the performance of the financial markets with the important economic variables. Most of what Chris has said, I agree with. The one thing I think is important that I don't agree with, it's not important, that important, is he thinks that we're going to have a, quote, hard landing, hard is too strong a word, on a recession in the first and second quarters of 2023. Based on the more recent numbers that I've seen, the January numbers, I think that's unlikely. I think it's likely to be more second and third quarter. I do agree with him that the forecast for all of 2023 has to be on the low side, and that it's likely to involve one or two quarters, I think probably two quarters, in which the economy contracts. And the principal reason, of course, that it would contract, or a number of reasons, but the principal reason would be obviously the imposition of higher interest rates on an economy which is already in the process. It was mentioned by one of you that I think it was you, Sandra. Excuse me. Should I call you Deputy Acting Budget Director or whatever? But you mentioned that the economy is in the process of slowing. And that's right. It is in the process of slowing depending on what you look at. But nevertheless, there are a lot of people that are saying, no, it's really not slowing. Especially when you look at the January numbers. Well, that's a little bit misleading. It gets a little bumpy along the way, but I think you're right. Whether you're taking a look at the employment numbers, look at them quarter by quarter, you'll see that they're slowing and the process is slowing. Take a look at retail sales, take a look at personal spending. You'll see it's not very consistent, nice and even and pretty, but nevertheless, it is, the economy is in the process of slowing. So it's not gonna take much to put the to cause it to go into a negative territory. When I talk about the financial markets, let me give you two distinct periods. There's 2021, when the average annual rate of return for the equity markets was from 2019 to 2021, roughly a 47%. It was a 47% increase, about a 20% average annual increase. And that's 2020 and 2021. Then we get to 2022, and as has been well pointed out by Chris, 2022 has been a negative year. But I think he also, importantly, I think, separated or pointed out that there's been a difference between the performance of the markets from January 4th through October 13th, and then a difference in the performance of the markets since October 13th. The markets have performed much better since October 13th. And I think it's important to reconcile the performance of the markets for those two distinct periods with the with what the markets, investors collectively are telling you. First of all, I think that if we start out, it's fairly clear that I think if you look at 2020 and 21, the word that I would use for 2020 and 21, and the word I would use also for 2022 is excessive. And the reason I'd use the word excessive, I think that the shift towards accommodation, let's call it accommodation by both the Federal Reserve and the federal government in Washington. The Federal Reserve obviously increasing the whole its holdings of financial assets by $6.4 trillion. The federal government in Washington through American Rescue Plan increased payments for unemployment insurance, a number of other programs, increased spending in 2020-21 by about $2.4 trillion. So you take the $6.4 and the $2.4 trillion, that invariably leads, as you might guess, to a significant increase in monetary growth rates. The growth rate of the economy, or the growth rate of the money supply in 2021 got up to 27 close to 28%. The highest we've ever seen is about 13%. The average since 1959 is approximately 6.8%. So monetary growth, because of the level of stimulus, was significant. And as you might expect, common sense will tell you that's going to lead to higher inflation, and it certainly did. 1.2% in 2020, 4.7% in 2021, and then, of course, up to 8% in 2022. That should not come as a surprise. I would only add, importantly, that even though that was excessive, based on financial and economic history, you had to do it. Keep in mind that the economy contracted at an average annual rate in the second quarter 2020 at a 30% rate. That's far and away the most significant direct contraction we've ever had in the U.S. economy. Second place goes, incidentally, if you care, to the first quarter of 1958, which was 10%. So, and then of course, 20 million people lost their jobs. So the level of stimulus in 2020 and 21. Although we call it excessive, and it was excessive in my judgment, it still was necessary. Too little, too late is the most significant lament of economists and policymakers, and I think this is a pretty good example. Then we get to, of course, 2022, and went the opposite direction. The Federal Reserve has now reduced the size of its balance sheet. Federal government in Washington, when you measure it on a year-to-year, year-over-year basis, has reduced its spending. The money supply, as measured by M2, is now down or has been reduced. And as you can imagine, that of course has created significant problems for the financial markets. It's created, first of all, not only a decline in the money supply, but liquidity conditions are now negative. When liquidity conditions are negative historically, the average annual rate of return for the stock market is 0.4%. When liquidity conditions are positive, the average annual return for the stock market is 14.4%. So liquidity conditions make a difference. As a result of the decline, the deterioration in liquidity conditions and a number of other indicators, the index of leading economic indicators, of course, indicators that tell us where we're going, not where we've been, have declined for 10 successive months. They've done that 10 times since 1959, and 8 times have been accompanied by an economic contraction or a recession. You also know that the yield curve, which is very controversial or highly argued, has been inverted. The yield curve has been inverted for a number of months now. It's inverted 11 times since 1959, and 8 of those times have been accompanied by, followed by an economic contraction or recession. So the case, when you look at the leading indicators, when you look at In my view, the yield curve, which remains inverted, the case for a contraction in the economy remains very strong. The Federal Reserve Bank in New York, and Jason will be on, the Federal Reserve Bank in New York measures the probability of a recession beginning in 12 months based on the inverted yield curve. And that's gone from, at the beginning of 2022, 6% up to, I saw the number for the month of January just yesterday, and I almost had heart failure, but it's a 56% now probability of a recession within the next 12 months, which would mean in 2023. So I think that based on those numbers, the case is fairly strong that we're going to have an economic contraction. The problem is trying to time it. You just heard first and second quarter by Chris. What you're going to hear is second and third quarter by myself. But even though I'm saying second and third quarter, forecasting the timing of when a recession is going to, if there's going to be a recession, and when the recession is going to start is, let's just say, difficult at best. I have a number of tables in a handout that I gave you, and I'm just gonna start on page six and just go through them briefly. Page six gives you a summary. Does everybody have this handout? Okay, one's missing over here. I think it's conceptually what I say is important. The numbers are not that important because, as I mentioned, they're going to change from month to month. I'm very impressed with what I've seen from a number of staff, especially the Ways and Means staff. Helene, those folks really do a great job. And the forecast, and I'm not saying that because I spend time with them. I'm saying that largely because I really, truly, honestly think that they do an extraordinarily thorough, comprehensive, and good job at reporting all the variables that we're going to be looking at for 23, 24, and they even give a hint as to what things are going to look like in 25. I've got 25 numbers down here as well. And essentially the outcome is essentially what we've been hearing already, which is 2022 is, let me just say a thing about 2023 as we start, and a thing about, just a comment about forecasting. When we started 2023 and we started to look at the January numbers, I mentioned this almost as a sort of an anecdote. The forecast, the strong consensus was first and second quarter. I was first and second quarter. I've changed to second and third quarter, and I've changed to second and third quarter largely because of the numbers we've seen for the month of January. December numbers, especially November and December numbers, were miserable. Then we started the month of January, and we all got surprised. The employment numbers were extraordinarily strong. Retail sales numbers up 3%. We haven't seen numbers like that. Very strong. And this was all wrapped up in the personal income numbers that we saw last Friday. And those personal income numbers told you that incomes remained fairly strong. Importantly, that consumption remained extraordinarily strong. And then in addition to that, it also gave us the final sort of information on inflation. And let me just say one thing about inflation, because it's important. And that is, when we take a look at all of the inflation reports for the month of January, a couple of things come to my attention, or should come to everybody's attention. We've seen inflation coming down since June, step by step. It didn't in January, but basically the pattern has been somewhat preserved. Inflation is in the process of declining, but not in January. But what you also saw in the month of January, which is extremely troubling, is an increase both at the consumer price, producer price, or rather personal consumption expenditure numbers. What you saw is an increase in the monthly rate. And now the focus is likely to shift from that year-over-year rate, which is such good news and makes us all feel good, to the month-by-month rate. The month-by-month rate was 0.5% for consumer prices, 0.5% for producer prices, or for the personal consumption expenditure, I think it was 0.6%. Now, you just do some simple math, and you ask yourself, if you get numbers like 0.5, The average is 0.3 more recently. Even using 0.3, how are you ever going to get to 2% inflation with numbers like that within a reasonable period of time? And doing that simple math, you'll find out that, no, you can't do it, which means, of course, the Federal Reserve sees that. I see it. Lots of folks see it. As a result, a lot of the forecasts for 2023 have been revised over the course of the last week. The consensus now is no longer first and second quarter. It's now second and third quarter and beyond. In addition, in response to some of the commentary made by non-voting members of the Federal Open Market Committee, mostly Bullard, made by non-voting members as well as these numbers, most people are rationally increasing or changing their forecasts for what the Federal Reserve's response is now going to be. The response now, or the rational response in my judgment, is they'll raise their rates, they'll raise their target for the federal funds rate by 25 basis points. This is incidentally consistent with what Chris is saying, by 25 basis points in March, May, and June, and possibly a fourth time. Keep in mind, in March, they will see the infamous dot plot once again, and they'll change, in my judgment, they'll change, as I think Chris has forecast, or increase what they would call the so-called terminal rate from 5% to 5.5%, which would get them, the latitude to increase their target for the federal funds rate in June to roughly 5.375% or 5.375%. In addition to that, there's no reason to believe that might be the end, but I think for our purposes, we're going to call that the end and hope that is the end and keep our fingers crossed that that's the end, or that's the highest rate at which the Federal Reserve is going to move to. If there is a soft landing or hard landing in the second and third quarters, as I'm suggesting, and if by some chance the rate of inflation continues to come down some, even the year to year, let me say something about the month-to-month in just a minute, but if that starts to come down, just maybe, and I say this maybe, and I really emphasize the word maybe, the Federal Reserve might take its foot off the brake or pause and not raise interest rates any further than they do in June for the remainder of this year. I wouldn't count on it, so be ready to change your forecast. That's what I'm saying. And keep in mind that the forecast for the federal funds rate, the numbers you use for the federal funds rate, statistically carry with them implications for the yield on a 10-year treasury. And if we get higher federal funds rates, we're going to get higher 10-year treasuries. I'm pretty much in Chris's camp. He said 4% on a 10-year treasury. I got 4.11% on a 10-year treasury, and that's statistically consistent with a 5.375 federal funds rate. I apologize for being a little technical, but nevertheless, those numbers do work. Let me say one thing about the month-to-month. Shelter is, as I think most of you who are watching this pretty closely, shelter is the biggest part of the consumer price index. And the increases we've seen in rental agreements have been one of the, it's roughly 50% of the consumer price index. And the last shelter increase we saw was 0.7%. Now you take 50% of the consumer price index, increase it by 0.7%, guess what's gonna happen to inflation? That's a big increase. But there's a lot of really good work done now on the so-called renegotiation of rental agreements. Everybody's focused on it and tracking it, and happily, the rental agreements are being renegotiated downward. And we're seeing that fairly on a widespread basis, and that will hit the consumer price index in the second half of 2023. Maybe we'll have to wait till the fourth quarter of 2023. But that's an important component of the outcome on inflation when we look at the second half of second half and fourth quarter, or look at the outcome for inflation. So if that keeps coming down and we get the soft landing, just maybe, cross your fingers, we might get the Federal Reserve pause or take their foot off the veritable break. I've also made some forecasts in here that are consistent with what I'm saying on not only the federal funds rate, but also 90-day T-bill, 10-year treasury, which of course means the yield curve, and stock prices. I have a very uncomfortably low forecast for stock prices, a negative return between now and the fourth quarter. The numbers are in here. Now in the fourth quarter of 2023, a positive, if you want to call it that, 3% increase average annual rate of return between now and the fourth quarter 2024, and then some better numbers, 6%, 7% between now and the end of 2025, when we get through this period of Federal Reserve restraint and real questions about the economy and earnings. So they're not inspiring forecasts for stock prices, but nevertheless, there's a forecast which is fairly carefully worked out or played out. I also include in here, and again, in the interest of time, I'm going to go through it fairly quickly. I'll just tell you that the numbers are in here, and it's worth mentioning. I have a forecast for New York State's economy. I forecast New York State's employment numbers. I forecast New York State's gross state product numbers. I also forecast, and I say this, gingerly, forecast revenues and I wouldn't pay much attention. I can only tell you that the total revenues, based on numbers that I got from the Ways and Means Committee, especially the personal income tax numbers, are statistically consistent with the forecast I've given for the New York State economy. More specifically on the New York State economy, continue to grow, but it's a strange thing. Almost every year I come in the same way, and I don't know why this is, and it all seems to work out this way. It's always New Hampshire, Massachusetts, New York. That's the way it is. And then you go down and you get Rhode Island and Vermont at the bottom of the list when I'm forecasting the New England states. I wish I could figure it out. Let me see. I think that's pretty much it, unless there are some questions, which I'll hold. Obviously, you want to hold the questions until later. On the PIT, I had 4% in 23, 7.2% in 24, calendar year 25, 8.9%. Not bad numbers, I don't think, but nevertheless, maybe, who knows. So the performance of the financial markets, in my judgment, is consistent. You ask, why has the performance been better since October 13th? And the reason that I think the performance has been better is I think investors collectively anticipate the outcome that I'm forecasting. And they are anticipating that there will be the soft landing, that the rate of inflation will come down, the rents will help the process, and that the Federal Reserve, not in 2023, but in 2024, will either pause, I think pause is the answer, or will take its foot off the brake and actually reduce rates. I don't think that's going to happen, but nevertheless, at least pause. Investors see that happening or coming to fore, and as a result, they become a little bit more optimistic. So we're seeing the performance of the financial markets is not what I would call bull market performance, but it's certainly encouraging, saying to me that investors are becoming somewhat more optimistic. Not great, but somewhat more optimistic. They see a good outcome. They see the end of the so-called cycle, the bear market cycle, to be followed by a bull market cycle. Coming to a theater near you is, I guess, the way to say it.
Thank you, Hugh. Next up, we'll talk to Jason Brum, who will be on Zoom.
Can you guys hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great, great. So thanks for having me again. Very sorry I couldn't, I love to come in person, and I see poor Hugh sitting there all alone. I wish I could keep you company, but you did a great job. So let me start off by, with everyone talking about the Federal Reserve, let me just make clear that any views I express are my own and not necessarily the views of Federal Reserve Bank of New York or the Federal Reserve System. I'm gonna focus on the New York State economy with an emphasis, as you'll see, on on real estate markets, but also employment and some interesting findings from our business surveys. So let me jump into slide number 2. Everyone has a paper copy, I believe, and they're numbered at the bottom. So slide number two looks at current economic conditions as measured by our two surveys, our manufacturing survey, which covers New York State manufacturers, and the business leader survey, which covers service firms throughout the tri-state area, but largely in New York State. And these are diffusion indexes where we basically ask, do you think things are getting better or getting worse? Is your activity increasing or decreasing? And the net result is going to be the diffusion index. So basically reading below zero simply means that there are more negative responses than positive responses. And so you can see if you look historically, it jumps around a little bit. It tends to go down right at the onset of recessions. And you see the very, very big decline where basically everyone said things are getting worse at the beginning of the pandemic. Since then, of course, we had a period of fairly good growth. But readings over the past, I would say, 6 or 7 months have tended to be negative in both the manufacturing and the service sectors. Not negative to the point where they're necessarily signaling a recession. You can see they've been at these kind of levels before in the past. But these are pretty very low levels, and I'll get into a caveat in a moment when we get to a few slides down. One encouraging thing was that even though they're still below zero, they did tick up a bit in February, and we're kind of hoping that this continues through to March. Slide three focuses on some of the other questions. So in addition to asking about business activity, we ask about price pressures. We ask about basically changes in companies' selling prices, the prices they receive, and the prices they pay. So the chart on the left has prices paid. Again, a diffusion index, you can see that in the early stages of the pandemic, it got quite low. Then, of course, in 2021 and into 2022, both the prices received and the prices paid got to pretty high levels. One interesting thing that you'll note is that the manufacturers were seeing more widespread price increases than service firms up until 2022. And then as we get into 2022, with the sort of supply disruptions easing a bit and, commodity prices, kind of leveling off a bit, you can see that in the second half of 2022, these price pressures and the prices received have come down. But in the last few months, these indexes on both the prices paid and prices received have kind of leveled off. So we're kind of, we're obviously, everyone's focused very much on the inflation data, which I'll talk about in a minute. Chart four is a question every few months we'll ask very more pointed and specific questions on various subjects. And of course, lately we've been looking a lot at prices and wages. So back in December, we asked businesses, well, what do you see your own selling prices and the prices you pay doing over the next 12 months? And this is what we call a trimmed mean, which you take out the outliers, the top five and lowest 5%. So you sort of get an average expectation, I guess. And what's interesting is everything is kind of around 5%. On selling prices, a little below for service firms, a little above for manufacturers, but on costs, a little bit higher for service firms. But what's interesting is companies' expectations for what's going to happen in their own neck of the woods, in a sense, tend to be a little bit lower than their expectations for overall inflation. Now, why do we look at this, and why in our on our consumer surveys, which I don't have anything on here, but they're giving similar pictures. Why do we ask about expectations? Is it that companies and people are great forecasters? Well, sometimes yes, sometimes no, but inflation expectations can shape business decisions. So that if you're a business and you're negotiating salaries and you expect your selling prices to go up a lot, you might be more inclined to be a little more generous with things like wages and such. And just budgeting more money for various inputs, in a sense. So anyway, this is the 5% expectations was back in December. More recently, in February, we asked questions about past and expected changes in wages and salaries. And this is interesting because we've been asking these questions for quite a number of years. We didn't do it during the first year of the pandemic, but we did it during the pandemic. And you can see that companies were basically, before the pandemic, were saying, yeah, things are going up like 3%, a little bit lower into the pandemic. And then, of course, in February 2023, which is just this past month, this month, in fact, you see this big spike where service firms are saying 6%, manufacturers are saying 5%. But we also asked about what they expect wages and salaries to do over the next 12 months. And there you see the numbers going back down to 3%. So this is not to say that this is how things exactly will pan out, but what it suggests is that the wage inflation, the acceleration in wages that we've seen over the past year is not expected to continue to sort of spiral, but is expected to continue increasing. Okay. In February survey and in past surveys as well, we also asked about job openings. So one of the problems we've been hearing, one of the challenges we've been hearing from businesses throughout the region and throughout New York State is that they're having a hard time finding enough workers and filling job openings. So we said, okay, how many job openings at the moment do you have? And then how many employees do you have total? So for each firm, that's intended to scale it to, you know, the size of the company. So a company that say has 100 people and they have like 10 job openings, so their figure will be 10%. A company that has 10,000 employees and has 200 openings would be about 2%. So we take these percentages and we average them across firms. Actually, we take the median percentage across firms, and you can see that it was running around 2.5% prior to the pandemic, and then in a year ago it was up to 5% approximately. And it still remains pretty high, but it's come down a little bit to a little bit over 4%. So, you know, when we talk about the idea of a recession, one of the things we've noticed, and this gets to the next chart, which is chart 7, is that usually employment and kind of economic activity measures track pretty closely together. And so employment is generally considered one of the most reliable economic and timely economic indicators, which it always has been. But one of the things we've been seeing lately is this sort of divergence. So companies are saying, well, yeah, things are getting worse, but employment is actually going up. And so these are two diffusion index. The activity index is basically the same measure I showed you a few slides back for just service firms. But this relationship is pretty similar in our manufacturing survey. And so even though our activity index has been below the zero threshold for quite a few months now, the employment measure, where we say, is employment at your firm going up or down, has been positive consistently. And this is one of the things that we're seeing, you know, when you look at the national releases, when you look at the releases for New York State, you see that job growth has been pretty good, even as, you know, companies are, there's other weak sectors of the economy, I guess. And if you go to chart 8, this is what we call a spider chart. Everything is indexed to the beginning of the pandemic here. So basically the level of the curves, this isn't intended to put everything on the same scale. It lets you see everything relative to where it was in February 2023. And you can see that prior to the pandemic, New York City was growing very strongly. Then during the pandemic, for obvious reasons, New York City and New York State got hit particularly hard with much bigger employment declines. And they've been kind of recovering at about the same rate as the US, but because the initial drop-off was so much more severe here, it's taken longer to come back. So whereas the U.S. employment is now comfortably above where it was, it's a bit above where it was prior to the pandemic, in New York State and especially New York City, it's trending up, but it's there's still a what we call a shortfall. Now, the next few charts, which is charts 9, 10, 11, and 12, I'm not going to, you know, go into great, you know, I'm going to run through them very quickly. But basically, in a few weeks, the New York Department of Labor is going to be issuing revised employment numbers. And the New York Fed does what we call an early benchmark estimate. So we kind of estimate based on, I won't get into the gory details, but based on other data that are used to come up with the revision to employment, because the employment is based on a survey. This is the establishment-based employment. So we do this early benchmark estimate, and it usually, you know, helps a little bit in predicting the revisions. So after that long speech, basically New York State, we don't expect to be revised very much. New York City, we expect maybe to be revised down, but just a tad. Upstate New York down, just a tad. And then without going through all the details, most areas look like they're going to get revised down a little bit. Now, I know what you're thinking, probably. You're thinking, well, if New York State isn't going to be revised, how can most areas be revised down? And the reason is that in the preliminary estimates, the sum of the areas don't always add up to the state. Once they're revised, they do. And so what we're expecting is in a number of upstate areas, which are already looking a little bit sluggish, we're expecting a little bit downward revisions. But I think the more important thing to focus on here is the fact that not only is New York State lagging in terms of this shortfall from where we were before the pandemic, but pretty much every area of New York State is experiencing that, with the lone exception of Ithaca. But even Ithaca is not probably quite up to where it was. So you know, the fact that things are lagging in upstate is kind of a and I don't like to say return to normalcy, but it's certainly a return to pre-pandemic trends. Upstate New York doesn't have the same kind of population growth that New York City's had, or especially that you know, Sunbelt regions have had. So these areas in terms of employment are lacking. And again, it's not necessarily because, you know, companies are reluctant to hire. It's more an issue of population and the working age population and the labor force, where, you know, employment growth is probably being held back by the fact that a lot of companies have a lot of job openings that they're unable to fill. So slide 13, I won't get into too much detail. These are sort of the sectors that are doing well. I was going to do a chart, but it's, I think, easier to just see it, a summary here. Not surprisingly, sectors like information and professional business services, transportation and warehousing, which of course were, if anything, boosted by the pandemic, are above pre-pandemic levels. Leisure and hospitality, which was the hardest hit sector, is certainly rebounding, especially in New York City, and these other sectors are. And then a number of sectors remain pretty sluggish. Retail trade, that wasn't doing very well before the pandemic, and it's continuing. And of course, these others, I don't need to read them out to you. So now, for the last part of the presentation, I'm going to focus on real estate markets. Because I think this is really important to understand what's going on. Hugh, I think, correctly noted that, you know, a big component of the CPI, and one of the reasons the CPI keeps going up, is that shelter prices are kind of in the CPI, are a lagging indicator. So what happens is, you know, when rents start going down, if you're in the midst of a 12-month lease, your rents aren't going to start going down yet. Whereas, you know, if you're buying cars or other things, you know, the prices respond pretty quickly. So it's important to look, I think, at home prices and rent. So here's what's been happening with home prices. Now, you might have expected, with mortgage rates going up from historically low levels to what I guess maybe younger people might consider a very high levels, but what you know, us, we old timers think of as kind of more normal levels. But home prices appear to have leveled off, but not really declined across upstate New York. And the magnitude of the increase, you can see this is again benchmarked to the beginning of 2020. You know, home prices in a lot of upstate New York went up 20 to 30%, which is in the course of less than 2 years. Actually in the course of about 2.5 years, which is pretty remarkable. And this has been something we've been seeing throughout the nation. When you look at slide 15, we have home prices in the five boroughs of New York City, which are the solid lines, and then some of the outlying counties. And what you see is this, before the last few months, what you saw was a huge run-up in prices everywhere except in New York City. In New York City, too, prices went up, but not nearly as much. And of course, two of the reasons are, one, that New York City was hit very hard by the pandemic, and urban areas in general and densely populated areas are not the optimal places people want to be during pandemics, but also because the shift to remote work has enabled people to be less close to their workplace. And so, you know, to the extent that a lot of people commute into New York City, or at least into the New York City area, that geographic link was weakened. And what will happen remains to be seen. That's probably a longer conversation that we can have here. If you look at slide 16, we also look at rents. Both of these, by the way, are based on Zillow data. The rents seem to have, I think they're seasonally adjusted, but they seem to have, at least since the pandemic, some seasonal swings. And you can see, again, Manhattan is the gray line. There was a gap in there because like almost nothing new was being leased, I think. But you can see that rents, which fell in the city and rose outside the city early on in the pandemic, all started to go up in 2021 and 2022. But since then, they seem to have leveled off, but not really declined yet. Or I shouldn't say yet. They have not really declined, but they have leveled off. And so what Hugh was talking about in the shelter component of the CPI, that is still going up, but at some point you would expect that to level off in line with these residential rents. And price to rent ratios, which is slide 17, remain quite high throughout the region, but especially in parts of New York City and Manhattan, which is probably a function of rents, which are more affected by, you know, immediate living conditions versus prices, which tend to be more based on what, you know, people expect. You know, you don't buy a home to be, you know, you buy a home for with a long-term investment. But in Manhattan, you can see they spiked up because rents fell sharply and they're kind of back to more normal levels throughout the region. And before I jump to the very last part, which is on the commercial real estate market, I have to say that, you know, we look at a lot of economic data, but we also go around, we talk to people in the region, you know, we try to get a lot of on the ground intelligence. And one of the things that's been striking in the last couple of years is the issue of housing affordability. We used to hear about it a lot in New York City, but when you get upstate, when we go to other parts of the district, even Puerto Rico's in our district, you know, there were other things that were more concerns. And right now, what we've been hearing lately is a shortage of housing almost everywhere we go, and concerns about housing affordability, concerns about constraints to construction for whatever reasons. And you know, one of the things that the pandemic did in a long-term sense was to I would think of it as an upward level adjustment in housing demand. So, you know, however much housing a typical family wanted or needed prior to the pandemic, now suddenly, oh, we're working at home 3 days, and that, you know, 50 square feet of office space or whatever that, you know, you use when you work, are now coming into the home. So anyway, this seems to be a supply-demand mismatch, a lack of construction combined with what I think of as an upward shift in demand has really, caused a lot of stress in the housing market. And then the last slide before the overview slide, slide 18, not surprisingly, office vacancy rates have gone up a lot in New York City, but even throughout the region, but, you know, they've gone up a lot more in New York City. And, you know, one of the reasons they keep going up, 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 and, you know, probably will do so for a little while longer, is that office leases tend to be longer term. And so it's only when they come up for renewal and a company doesn't renew, or they reduce their footprint or reduce the amount of office space they have, that that space suddenly goes into the vacancy or availability category. So, you know, one of the things that has been happening in New York City, as many of you, I'm sure, know over the last 30, 40 years, probably since I've been alive, is, you know, conversions of office space, old office space to residential space. And now with demand for office space going down and demand for residential space in the city, seemingly much stronger, that trend is certainly like to continue. Okay, I feel like I've rambled on long enough, but just to sort of wrap up, our regional business surveys show inflation receding a bit, business slowing or business having slowed, employment though is doing pretty well. Housing markets have cooled in recent months, but I think, that's relative to what was going on for the last 2 years. And then commercial real estate markets, of course, been weak, reflecting the ongoing prevalence of remote work. There are a few appendix slides that I'm not going to talk about, but I'll be more than happy to answer any questions when we get to that point. So sorry to take so long. Thank you for listening. And that's it.
Thank you, Jason. Now we'll turn to our last presenter. Karan, please, again on the web.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. So unfortunately, Professor Larry was in transit, so I'll be presenting on his behalf. My name is Karan Basin. I'm a PhD student under him. And today we'll be going through the economic model that Professor Larry and Cheng Yang, who was a former student at SUNY Albany, have prepared for New York State. And thanks to all the experts who have, spoken about their individual forecasts. So let me begin by stressing on what this forecasting model is all about. Essentially, it's a two dynamic factor model, and what they do here is that they have a New York State, and then they have a U.S. And adjoining states as a separate kind of part of the model, and they've got different variables to assess the state of the economic activity which is happening in the New York State region, and then which is happening outside of New York State in the U.S., etc. And many of these variables are quarterly, and some are monthly, so it's a mixed frequency model in that sense. And that actually allows them to have a more real-time updating of forecasts, which gives a more accurate assessment of tax revenues, as things proceed during the fiscal year. Typically, they begin with their first forecast around 18 months before the end of the fiscal year. So that would be, say, September. And they are updated, as I said, on a real-time basis when more data comes at a monthly frequency. One of the highlights of the model is that it pays special attention to the probability of a recession. And I think that has become more important for the coming fiscal year, given that there has been a lot of talk about slowdown, both for, the U.S. and the New York economies in general. And since both U.S. and New York economy have different business cycles, it's important to model them separately and understand how these two kind of, interact over a period of time. So another variable that is, of course, quite interesting here is the expected effect on revenues, which comes from the National Association of Survey of Business of Budget Officials. And these are people who are involved in making of the budget, and therefore their assessment of tax policy changes is often of interest and of use to, professional forecasters and those involved in modeling of real-time economic indicators. Since this model is primarily focused in forecasting fiscal year revenues, it's essentially looking at real-time year-over-year growth rates and then arriving at the tax revenue figures for the fiscal year. This model, incidentally, was recently published in a peer-reviewed journal, which is the International Journal of Forecasting. So this came out in 2022. So the model has been peer-reviewed, and it has some really nice properties in terms of forecasting tax revenues, etc. So before we move forward, we're going to go to slide four. I think we're going to talk about some key variables and the time series dynamics that we have seen over the last couple of years, especially since the pandemic, and then we're going to go into the model one by one. So if you can look at slide four, what is particularly interesting is that initial claims for New York are basically at the pre-pandemic levels, and this highlights that the economic recovery from the pandemic has been swift, in the sense that it has been happening gradually, but now we are back to the pre-pandemic levels. Of course, we see a slight uptick towards the last couple of months, and that is a bit of a issue which is captured by the model per se. The other variable which is also of enormous interest is on slide five, and this comes from the U.S. Department of Transportation. So this is an index which was developed at SUNY Albany by Professor Larry some time back, and it is in a way showing that the transportation services are yet to be fully recovered. So even though in terms of real economic growth or in terms of the levels of GDP, when we look at that data, we see that the recovery is on track. But when we look at more granular indices, we find that there's still a bit of a room for further improvement. So if you go to the next slide, you see that we have the US leading economic index from the Conference Board, and it basically is signaling an upcoming recession. And as I said, the good thing about this model is that it has a variable to capture the probability of a recession and adjust the forecast as we go along. So in slide seven, once we move there, what we have is the Google Mobility for New York. And unfortunately, the series has been discontinued, but it shows that, again, mobility levels were recovering for New York. And the reason it's important, at least for New York City, is because retail, recreation, and workplace actually contribute a lot of economic activity for that city. And the last data point that we have for it is December of 2022. And what we can see is that gradually, but it has been, a sustained recovery since the pandemic lows. What is also quite important is to measure, economic recovery through some high frequency indicators. So slide eight has auto traffic, which is measured, for Pennsylvania, New York, and New Jersey, the six major crossings. There's a lot of volatility that we still see, and it still is, yet to recover to the pre-pandemic levels. Some amount of it could be because of people choosing to move less or work from home, etc. But when you look at slide nine, and there we are focusing just at truck traffic, for these six crossings, that seems to have recovered quite a bit. And this is a better indicator of economic activity, because what it is showing is that there is some movement of goods which is happening, and that movement has, gone above the pre-pandemic levels over the last couple of months. Now we turn to slide nine, where we have New York electricity generation. If you look closely, what we see is that electricity growth has been declining over the last decade. So that's like more of a structural decline, which is particular for the state. But this variable is again important to capture a lot of dynamics or the cycle for the New York business cycle per se. And that's why this variable would also enter into the model. Slide 10 goes to consumer expectations, you know, for business conditions. And the average consumer expectations for business conditions continues to remain very low. It's also very volatile. And basically that is, again, you know, alluding to the fact that the odds of a weakening of economic conditions are more likely going forward. Slide 12 has the Philadelphia Fed coincident index. And this basically has unemployment, real wage, average hours worked by production workers, etc. And this has recovered a great deal since the pre-pandemic, or rather the pandemic level. So this is kind of encouraging in that sense. But again, you know, what we see from different indicators is that we need to take a closer look at the business cycle for both New York and US in isolation, and then, you know, how they both kind of relate together. And that's why what this model does is it relies on dynamic factors to a large extent. So slide 12 goes into the blue chip average forecast for the next year. And at the moment, the real GDP forecast for next year is around 1%, which of course is lower, you know, than what has been the norm for some time, at least in the post-pandemic period, since the recovery started. But again, these forecasts are bound to be revised over a period of time as more and more data comes through. Slide 14 looks at economic policy uncertainty. And the economic policy uncertainty index is not high, but there seems to be an upward trend lately, and it continues to be slightly volatile. And this particular series is a hybrid of three measures. And the reason why it's important is because there's, you know, a lot of evidence that higher economic uncertainty weighs down on a lot of economic decisions, particularly from firms. So again, this might, you know, give a sense of why firms expect some amount of weakness going forward in the business conditions. Now, a lot of these variables, you know, essentially are very useful for mapping the economic conditions for New York State and for, of course, the US economy. And as we know, tax revenues are a function of economic growth. So, you know, they're useful for getting a sense of where revenues are going to be going forward. And if you look at slide 5, there we have the monthly taxes from New York Tax Department. And that has been quite volatile since the pandemic. So again, you know, when we look even closer to recent data, it has been coming down, which again, you know, is something that is worth looking closely at. And the next slide, of course, in slide 16, we have the list of variables that feed into the model. And what you can see is that there are variables that feed in with different frequencies. So for instance, probability of decline in GDP, which is a quarterly variable that we get from the Federal Reserve Bank of Philadelphia, that basically gives a sense of recession. That's a quarterly frequency variable. And then we have variables that are more monthly. So if we have, you know, the entire suite of ISM variables that feed into the model for US, each of which are at the monthly frequency. Then there's, you know, variables such as transportation index that we saw just towards the starting of the presentation, which again is a high frequency economic indicator, which is of use for the model. Slide 17 gives a list of the variables for New York State. And here we have, you know, variables such as initial claims, early benchmark employment, you know, we have employment numbers, and then there's home sales, home prices to gather a sense of what's happening in the housing market, given its importance. Then there are variables that measure movement of truck traffic, auto traffic, and, you know, electricity generation. Again, some of the variables are at quarterly frequency, some of the variables are at monthly frequency. Since this is a mixed frequency model, it's important to have both. And both of them are quite useful to update the forecast on a real-time basis. So based on these variables, we generate dynamic factors. You know, so you have a composite factor for the US and a composite factor for New York. Slide 18 gives the composite factor for US, and slide 19 has it for New York. And if you look at both these slides closely, what you find are two important facts. A, that the business cycle for US and New York are not almost always the same. So there's variation in the extent of the peak and the trough of a business cycle and the timing of the business cycle for US and New York State. And second, that both the composite factors for US and New York has been falling in recent months, indicating weakness in economic activity. So when we, you know, look at this weakness in the economic activity, this is quite useful for feeding into the model and drawing out a forecast for fiscal year tax projections. And that's one of the reasons why we rely on this approach and have two dynamic factors, one for US and one for the New York State separately, with different variables feeding into both. Essentially, what we do is we build on multiple sources. So we have the NASBO, DOB, ways and means. And what we do is we create an additional policy change variable that captures experts' judgment on the effects of recent tax policy changes on tax revenues for the next financial year or the fiscal year. And the reason why this is important is because budget officials typically have a better sense of the impact of tax policy changes. So their expert opinion has to in some way contribute to our ability to draw out a forecast using a model. So their qualitative expectations kind of feed in. And then we, you know, estimate the forecast uncertainty with Bootstrap. If you move to slide 21, that has our real growth forecast of tax revenues for fiscal year 2023. And at present, it is at minus 14.3. And in nominal terms, that's minus 7.4% or $109.7 billion. So that's what the model is telling us for the fiscal year 2023. For fiscal year 2024, you know, it's important to highlight that our real growth forecast at the moment, of course, is subject to higher uncertainty. A, because, you know, the forecasting horizon is long, and B, because of general uncertainty regarding the state of the economy. As more data will become clearer, you know, we would be much more closer to give a more accurate projection with a narrower, you know, confidence interval. But as of today, the real growth forecast of tax revenues for fiscal year 2024 is minus 6%, so it's a 6% decline. And the nominal decline would be minus 2.6%. So it's a minus 2.6% nominal decline. And I would now go to the last slide to conclude the projections. Basically, our 14-month ahead forecast is at minus 2.6% of nominal growth, which translates to $106.8 billion based on the $109.7 billion now cast for the current financial year. This, of course, includes tax department data, which, you know, has PTET, the pass-through entry tax, as a part of the data that we are using. And based on the professional forecasters, their assessment and what we have discussed so far in this meeting, that economic growth is going to be tepid in 2023 and a rebound in 2024, there still remains considerable disagreement about the extent of weakness in economic activity. Nevertheless, the expectation of a recession in 2023 remains strong despite that disagreement. And I think that's important to factor in while preparing any forecast of tax revenues. However, given the experience of underestimating revenues during the last 2 years, you know, I think we should avoid such underestimation. And one thing that we must appreciate is the buildup of the rainy day fund, which has, you know, which is a highly commendable decision by the New York State. And it must be appreciated because that gives them the necessary buffer to deal with all kinds of, you know, external unforeseen shocks that the New York State economy might be subjected to. Over the next couple of months, of course, as clearer picture emerges with new data coming in, the uncertainty around the forecast will be resolved in a by and large, and we would be able to give a more accurate projection of tax revenues for the coming fiscal year. With that, I thank you all for an opportunity to present during today's meeting.
So thank you for doing that for us. I also found comfort in some of the data sources you were using, because at the New York State Budget Division, we used a tremendous amount of those data sources when we were doing our economic analysis on decisions to be made during the COVID shutdown. So I too hope that some of those data sources come back and we can get to a place with government that not all artificial intelligence is used for bad purposes. So with that, I guess we'll open it up to questions. And my main one is, you know, balancing everything that we heard today and the economic risks, where does the preponderance of evidence point for 2023? Yes.
Well, I think that you've got a somewhat of a consensus, I mean, to a downturn in the economy. And the question, I don't know if there's a consensus, but I think I would, you know, just personally put it at second and third quarter, but I have no idea. I had it at first and second quarter, and I heard first and second quarter from Chris. Jason did not make a forecast because he focused on New York State, and I'm not sure what the last speaker would say. I'm not sure, but I think the real question is, the slowdown is continuing, and the question is, will it be a hard landing or a soft landing? That's the debate. You know where I'm coming from.
Chris, anything well, you'd like to add? Go ahead.
Sorry. I mean, again, my opinion, not that of the Federal Reserve. It's true, I don't do forecasts, but I don't know. I feel like people are, you know, I think a recession is certainly possible, but people are acting like it's a done deal, and I don't see that. You know, it's true that the yield curve is definitely signaling that, but, you know, I was watching one of the financial shows the other day, and they were asking someone that, they were saying, well, you know, should interest rates, long-term rates really be this low? And they were like, well, yeah, because we're probably heading into recession. They're like, well, why do you think we're heading into recession? And they said, because the yield curve is inverted. And they said, well, the yield curve is inverted. Why? Oh, because long-term rates are low. So this is kind of circular logic. But in all seriousness, having said that, though, I think, you know, when you're doing budgeting and you're trying to plan ahead, it's definitely, again, my opinion is it's a good idea to err on the cautious side. So, you know, pay attention to the more negative people than me. That's all.
Yeah, I would endorse what Jason said. A recession is not inevitable. I think it is still the best bet. And then, as Hugh pointed out, is, you know, when does it start? How severe is it? How long does it last? A lot of the data that Karan presented in Lahiri's deck, you know, showed a vast number of series are pointing in the direction of a recession. We personally don't put a lot of weight on the inversion of the yield curve. It's always possible that this time is different. I mean, it is a great predictor. It's, you know, basically been the inversion has preceded every other recession. This time could be different. The size of the Fed's balance sheet is exerting a lot of downward pressure on long-term yields. That adds to the inversion. It needs to be taken with a large grain of salt. But I think a mild recession remains the best bet. A lot of uncertainty as to when it begins. But Jason's right, it's not inevitable.
47 economic contractions since 1960 of the G7 countries, 29 of them, of the 47, have been, I don't want to use the word caused, that might be too strong, but certainly monetary policy has contributed to 27 of the 40, 29 of the 47. So monetary policy is a big, big part of the equation.
Thank you all. Senator Gennaris, any questions?
No.
Assemblywoman Weinstein, no? Questions?
You talked about looking at the moving from Q1 and 2 to 2 and 3 in terms of what you're looking at, and Jason kind of just commented on it as well, so in terms of it not being an inevitability. So just wondering, is there a potential that, you know, we continue to see numbers like you saw in January and this pushes further out, and what is that, how does that look in the future in terms of an economic downturn down the road, but also where is inflation, if that's the case?
It's a really good question. It's a possibility that we could continue to have numbers like January, no question, that we could have a, not only a soft landing, but an expansion in the economy. This is, I don't want to say it's a guessing game, but I think Chris is probably best to answer the question. He said the I think he's implying that the preponderance of the evidence amongst economists is points to some sort of a contraction of the economy. But I wouldn't buy it necessarily. It might not happen. And then what it really means is it probably means that, especially on the services side, which has been mentioned a lot, is services side, the employment and services side, inflation rate will continue to be high, unacceptably high, and the Federal Reserve will have to keep raising interest rates. I have a person that works with me who's really good, a really good economist, and she says 6% is the terminal rate, or even higher. And basically the underlying predicate is that the economy continues to expands at a much higher, she doesn't look at the numbers. She talks to companies, and she says what she's learning from companies, and Jason would be great on this, she talks to companies, and the companies are telling her that business is great, and they plan to not necessarily raise, well, they might raise prices, and things are just good, and where are you guys coming from? And she's an economist, a professional economist, and that's where she gets her information, and she would disagree with us.
It's like the weather preview. Senator Griffo?
I was going to say that. It's almost like we're listening to meteorologists, right? So, Hugh, one of the things that you talked about indicators being a very important aspect of making this assessment, right? And we all understand questions on accuracy with long-term considerations. But if you had to pick one particular indicator, would one be more important than the other that we should really be watching at this point as a barometer?
No, that's a really great question for a reason I'm just going to state really quickly. I've been asked that question before, and I would say something like the yield curve, and we've heard a lot about the yield curve. But the one mistake you can make is there are 10 components of the index of leading economic indicators, and a mistake that I've made over and over again is putting too much weight on any one indicator. We have to look at all of them. And especially as Jason has mentioned a number of times, diffusion indicators are really helpful. But it's a mistake to look at any one. I think the one that I like the best, and I hate to say it, is the stock market, because investors tend to get this right. Investors collectively get it right. And over time, if you got the right period of time, the markets will tell you what's coming. Now that's me, but I know that it's a mistake to hang my hat on that. You got to look at all 10 leading indicators and others if you can find them.
I just want one quick other thing, Sandy, to Chris. You talked about some of the key risks and the obvious things, the international incidents and situations and circumstances. But you talked about policy imperfection. Would that be an admonishment to everybody as we begin to look at this document that we should be looking at how we undertake this and priorities and what the potential impact and effect could be if poor decisions are made?
Yes.
Thank you.
Maria, anything closing? Thank you to everyone for your time, and thank you to our presenters for once again doing this on behalf of New York State's budget process. Thank you.